This hearing of the Subcommittee on Government Organization, Efficiency and Financial Management will come to order. We certainly appreciate everyone's participation and especially our witnesses. In the interest of time management, we're going to dispense with opening statements here with committee members and submit our statements for the record and leave the record open for 7 days for any other members to submit opening statements or extraneous material and go right to our witnesses. And we are honored to have three very distinguished public servants. We are grateful for your participation here today and especially for your work day in and day out as part of the Federal Government's work on behalf of all of our nation's citizens. Honored to have the Honorable Jean Dodaro, Comptroller General of the United States, Daniel Werfel, Comptroller of the Office of Management and Budget, and the Honorable Richard Gregg, Fiscal Assistant Secretary of the Department of Treasury. Again, we have had a chance to review your written statements, and we appreciate that preparation that you provide us. It allows us to be a little more prepared for a good engagement here today. Practice of the committee, if I could ask now that you are all seated to stand and we will swear you in. If you raise your right hand, I do solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you are about to give this committee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So let the record reflect that all witnesses answered in the affirmative. And Mr. Comptroller General, we'll begin with you, and again, appreciate your participation here today.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It's a pleasure to be here this morning, Ranking Member Tons. Nice to see both of you to discuss the results of our latest review of the financial statements for fiscal year 2011. I might take this opportunity, Mr. Chairman, with your announcement that you are not running for re-election. I just want to take this opportunity to thank you on behalf of myself and all my colleagues at the GAO for your dedication to financial management improvement. I think your efforts at the DHS Accountability Act and improper payments, you know, working on a bipartisan manner with your colleagues has really made a difference, and I just want to thank you for that.
Well, Mr. Comptroller General, I appreciate the kind words, and it's been a remarkable experience for the last 12 years. And I don't know what's next, but look forward to whatever that chapter is. But as I said before we started, working with you and your staff at GAO has been a great experience, and we're grateful. And working with my ranking member, my former chairman, we kind of keep swapping seats, who's chairman and ranking member. But the approach I know that we've taken along with you and our other witnesses is just a team effort. And it's been a real privilege to work with you and all here in Washington on behalf of the people of my district. So appreciate the kind words.
Sure. Thank you. Yeah, you leave with our appreciation and best wishes. With regard to our report this past year, as will be no surprise to either of you, we again disclaim to give an opinion on the accrual-based audited financial statements of the U.S. government. Three main reasons remain: serious financial management problems at the Department of Defense and issues at Treasury with both preparing the consolidated financial statements and eliminating intergovernmental transactions. Now, there are a few important developments with regard to DOD that I'd like to highlight this morning. First, in addition to this committee's focus, the House Armed Services Committee has had a special panel on DOD financial management, held a number of hearings, issued a report encouraging them to continue with their improvements. So the Congress is getting, you know, more actively engaged, and I think that's a very positive development and hope that it continues as DOD progresses. And also having the Congress set a firm deadline of 2017 in terms of auditability for the Department is an important step. Secondly, Secretary Panetta has advanced those goals by setting a date of 2014 for the audits of statement of budgetary resources. This is a very important early step, and I think will give indications as to whether or not they are going to be able to make the 2017 date as well, because it will highlight additional problems up front. Thirdly, is that the Department has set priorities for the beginning of their financial management improvements in dealing with budgetary resources and also the existence and completeness of military assets. These are the things they care about at the Department. And I think if they can't make progress in these areas is going to be even more difficult in dealing with some of the other issues associated with preparing financial statements. So I think all these elements, against the backdrop of a lot of fiscal pressure that the Department is going to be under, are creating the proper environment, hopefully, for improvements. Now, one should not underestimate the serious challenges that DOD is going to face in improving their controls and systems and the skills of their workforce, but I think these are encouraging signs. With regard to Treasury, they have taken some important steps in order to help deal with intergovernmental transactions by engaging the agencies on a quarterly and regular basis, which I think is very important. And they have also signaled their intent to prepare financial statements for the general fund transactions, which is really important in order to really figure out how to finally deal with this intergovernmental transaction issue. There hasn't been enough transaction history in order to make sure that they can find and eliminate all these transactions. This will create a better record for them to eliminate those transactions. Also, again, we have identified weaknesses in improper payments, in information security, and in tax collection activities, and I would be happy to talk about any of those in the Q's and A's. Just in closing, Mr. Chairman, I said it is really critical that the Federal Government continue to make progress in addressing these financial management challenges I have just outlined at DOD and Treasury. But it is really important also that the civilian agencies continue to maintain their record of improvements and sustain that going forward. All these things are critical to make sure there is proper accountability and stewardship of the taxpayers' funds, and also to more effectively manage the cost of government. And all this occurring against a backdrop of really long-term serious challenges facing our Federal Government. So I thank you for the opportunity to be here today, and at the appropriate time be happy to answer any questions.
Well, thank you for your testimony. You certainly hit, I think, some of the important high points, and your reference specifically on the improper payments with Mr. Towns introducing recent legislation along with Senator Carper in the Senate to take kind of the next step, even going a little further on how we can continue to tighten up the issue of improper payments and preventing that from occurring up front rather than after the fact trying to collect the money back. So look forward to working with you and your staff on that issue as well. So, Mr. Werfel.
Thank you, Chairman Platts and Ranking Member Towns, for the invitation today to discuss the state of financial management in the Federal Government, and in particular the 2011 Consolidated Financial Report of the United States. Sound financial management is essential to the effective stewardship of taxpayer dollars and enabling agency decision makers to make tough choices on day-to-day and long-term management challenges. In this time of tight budgets, families across the country are sitting around their kitchen tables and figuring out how to make the most out of every penny, and they should expect nothing less from their government. To meet this commitment, last year the Administration launched a campaign to cut waste, dedicated to combing through the entire Federal Government and rooting out any areas of waste and inefficiency. And we have made tremendous strides to date. We are cutting real estate costs, driving down the amount of improper payments the government makes, closing data centers and saving money on information technology, and reducing administrative costs across the board. Underlying all these efforts is the need for robust accounting practices, effective internal controls, and reliable financial reports. These tools create an environment where agencies can be more effective in meeting our most critical bottom-line result: effective and efficient programs free of error and waste. In addition to providing a comprehensive view of the Federal Government's finances, its current position, as well as issues and conditions that impact future operations, the financial report provides us with an annual update on agency financial audit results, a critical indicator of the success of our efforts to strengthen financial management practices across government. On those efforts, I am pleased to report that great progress was made in 2011. 23 of the 24 CFO Act agencies obtained an audit opinion, the best performance by the Federal Government to date, and only 2 agencies received a qualified opinion. Moreover, auditor-identified material weaknesses continued to decline. And again, all major agencies met the 45-day deadline for producing audited financial statements at year-end. These successes are due to the tireless efforts, leadership, and long-term commitment of our federal agencies. For example, this year NASA was able to overcome long-standing challenges with reporting certain assets and achieve a clean opinion on their financial statements for the first time since 2002. Similarly, the sustained leadership and persistence of the Department of Homeland Security led to them obtaining an opinion on their balance sheet for the first time since the Department's inception. And although DOD was not able to obtain an audit opinion, they have significantly accelerated their efforts for getting there, with Secretary Panetta specifically expressing his strong commitment to achieving an audit of the Department's budgetary statement by 2014, which would establish a firm foundation for full financial auditability by 2017. As we move forward on these efforts, we are cognizant that a foundation now exists that enables us to go beyond the balance sheet to ensure every dollar spent on programs and services is spent wisely. In today's continually challenging fiscal environment, wasting money is inexcusable and cannot be tolerated. As I mentioned earlier, we have already made tremendous progress in cutting administrative costs, saving money on real estate, reducing improper payments, and other key reforms under the campaign to cut waste. But in each of these areas, there is still significant work to be done in order to cut waste and improve efficiencies wherever possible. To achieve these goals, we will continue to improve financial management and identify ways to better manage and report on how the federal government spends taxpayer dollars. I look forward to working with Congress, GAO, and the financial management community to achieve our mutual goal of providing reliable and relevant financial information in a readily available and easily accessible format. And since I finished a minute early, let me echo Mr. Dodaro's comments about your service to this country, to this subcommittee, Chairman. I just mentioned earlier in my career, I think it was around 2003, I saw you give a speech on the CFO Act and financial management generally. And some of the themes that you emphasized in terms of the purpose of the CFO Act and that are you talked a lot about the audits that we do on a quarterly and an annual basis. Financial statements are a means to a larger end of better management and better data for information and decision making. Those certainly resonated with me as I was starting out in financial management in 2003. I started my career in government in 1997, but got into financial management right at that time I saw that speech. And it was very helpful for me in terms of formulating my approach and my strategic vision for financial management from OMB's perspective. So for all your work, OMB thanks you and wishes you the best of luck in the future.
Thank you. Mr. Gregg, Secretary Gregg.
Chairman Platts, Ranking Member Towns, thank you for inviting me to talk about the financial report for the United States Government for fiscal 2011. Your interest in financial management is greatly appreciated. The financial report provides the U.S. Government, the President, Congress, and the American people with a comprehensive view of the Federal Government's financial position. The projections in the report demonstrate that we must continue to take action to put the federal budget on a more sustainable path. The Obama administration is committed to meeting that challenge. The Affordable Care Act of 2010 and the Budget Control Act of 2011, both of which Congress passed and President Obama signed, are expected to help bring the government's expenditures more in line with its receipts. Together, these two laws substantially reduce the estimated long-term fiscal gap. But there is still more work to be done. The fiscal 2013 budget that President Obama submitted on February 13th seeks to build on that progress through a balanced plan for deficit reduction. The President's budget reduces projected deficits by a total of more than $4 trillion over the next 10 years by adding more than $3 trillion in deficit reduction to the approximately $1 trillion in savings already enacted through the BCA. These savings would cut the deficit and begin placing the federal debt on a downward path as a share of the economy by the middle part of the decade. Addressing our nation's fiscal challenges will require a sustained commitment, not just today, but for the long term. As Secretary Geithner has said, quote, restoring fiscal sustainability will require substantial additional changes, including tax reforms to increase revenue and changes to make our entitlement program sustainable over time. But these reforms, if done in a broad-based and balanced way and phased in over time to give Americans a chance to plan and adjust, will not impose an unfair or excessive burden on the citizens of this country. Let me turn to the financial report. The Federal Government, as Mr. Dodaro had said, continues to receive a disclaimer of opinion on the government-wide audit. Last year, I spoke to the subcommittee about my personal commitment to addressing the audit issues for which Treasury is primarily responsible, the mitigation of the intergovernmental out-of-balance conditions, and to improve the process for compiling the report itself. I think we have made significant progress on those two fronts over the last year. Treasury, working in cooperation with OMB and GAO and all the Federal agencies, is pursuing a number of strategic solutions to resolve these issues and improve financial management across government. For example, we have launched a coordinated, multifaceted effort to resolve intergovernmental differences, including working groups that get together and identify areas where we can not only clear out the out-of-balance conditions, but resolve the underlying problems. We have taken the lead in working with agencies to resolve reconciliation differences. We are creating metrics to go out to the agencies to measure their performance, and we are developing an automated system to address the buy-sell issue, which is a complicated one in this area. In addition, in this fiscal year, in fact in June, we will implement a central account group or general fund against which millions of transactions can be reconciled and validated. The original government-wide accounting construct lacked a central account of this type, giving rise to the audit issues that we've been facing. And while additional work is certainly necessary, we continue to clear out many of the audit issues that GAO has identified over the years. Let me just touch on a few financial management areas that complement what Danny said about things that are going on within the government and within Treasury. Within Treasury, we have launched a automated electronic invoice that any government agency can use to move away from paper invoice processing to electronic processing. It will save money and improve performance. Treasury has also worked to accelerate the use of electronic transactions. Many of our payments are now made electronically as a result of an initiative we started a couple of years ago. We've moved savings bonds from paper to electronic, and we've also have the tax payments coming into Treasury almost all electronic these days. Those three initiatives alone will save about $500 million. We're working with OMB to improve the payment process and to identify potential for improper payments before the payments go out through the Go Verify program that we have put together. And there's a host of other things that we have done. And the last one I'd mention is the provision in the fiscal 2013 budget that consolidates the two fiscal bureaus that report to me, Public Debt and FMS. And we're doing that primarily to give us a greater opportunity to help other agencies across the government in the financial management realm. We're also going to save some money, but the primary reason is to strengthen our capacity to deal with financial management and to be a leader in financial management across government. Mr. Chairman, that concludes my remarks. I would like to echo what my two colleagues said about your work over the years in providing great leadership in this area. It's been greatly appreciated by all of us in Treasury who've sat in this chair. And you'll be sorely missed. So, thank you.
Well, thank you, Mr. Secretary. And it's been an interesting experience in working with Mr. Towns on the subcommittee over the years, and trying to raise awareness in the general public, I guess, that the issues that all of you deal with every day are critically important. And I reference back that. Years back when we had a hearing on steroids in baseball and you couldn't fit everyone or all the cameras in this room, and I'm a huge baseball fan, but hey, if they want to kill themselves, doing steroids, you know, that's not a priority issue for this committee. And yet when we're talking about how we spend trillions of dollars, we have a lot of empty seats. And you know, the issues you're working on every day really are the issues that this committee and federal government needs to be focused on. So I appreciate all of your nice words, and certainly you know look forward to a final 10 months working with you, and then I'll be a private citizen, and then I'll keep tracking how we're doing. So, but we're going to try to get through some questions here. The votes have gone up, but we're going to try to get through as many as we can so that ideally we don't have to have you wait while we run over. I'm going to start with, and Danny, Mr. Werfel, you started or referenced an issue I wanted to start with, which is what is the real purpose of what we do when it comes to audits and financial statements, and that's to have knowledge that we can then act on, and not just once a year, but throughout the year, and to be able to make informed decisions. And I'll start with you, but if any of the three of you want to comment, what percentage of the departments and agencies do you think are still having to make heroic efforts to make that 45-day deadline, as opposed to having in place the systems that really are going to generate the information at the end of the year, ready for audit, that we really are after? Because that's what's going to ultimately benefit the department heads, the agency officials in day-to-day management. I know it's going to be an estimate or a guesstimate, but any ideas?
I would say that about roughly 70% of the major agencies at this time have hit their stride and gotten their sea legs.
7-0. Okay.
Where that's not to, but I don't mean to say that they're as efficient as they can be, but I'd say that they've hit the point where there's a routine nature to the manner in which the financial statements are put together and the year-end activities occur. Every once in a while, within those agencies, there's some kind of surprise that comes up in October that's unexpected, and there's a lot of scrambling, and we might ramp into heroic efforts mode. But more and more, I think we've achieved a stability. There are several agencies out there that still, it's a lot of workarounds, and it's a lot of manual processes, and use the term heroic efforts. It's just not the right efficiency point. Just haven't hit their efficiency, and that impacts how they can manage more to the bottom line. And I said in my remarks, the goal here is that financial statement reporting, internal controls, basic accounting become a routine functionality. So that where you're doing your heroic efforts and where you're, you know, staying up at night worried is around things that are more impactful to the bottom line, like are the dollars going to the right person in the right amount?
Yep. So. Senator Darrow?
Yeah. I agree with Danny that things have gotten much, much better over time. There's no question about it. Another benchmark, though, that we look at is whether or not the agencies are able to be in compliance with the Federal Financial Management Improvement Act, and you still have 11 of the agencies that are in out of compliance with one of the three requirements there in terms of standard general ledger or whether they're following accounting standards, you know, generally accepted accounting standards or federal systems requirements. But it's much, much better. Mm-hmm. It's hard to quantify, but there's no question that it's market improvement from where we started back in 96 and 97 with these audits.
Right.
There's no question. A couple of areas that one of the area that there's still heroic efforts is still at the IRS on the tax collection activities, which is why we list that as a material weakness. We're still using their statistical sampling estimates to estimate the tax receivables. There's really not yet a good system there. They're making good strides with their system improvement efforts, but I'd like to see more improvement over there, because I think it would benefit the taxpayers as well as the government in that particular case. And of course, we have the issues at DOD and DHS and a few others. But by and large, I'd give it much improved situation. We just need to keep it there.
Yeah.
I'm concerned, you know, if you notice, some agencies slip out of unqualified opinion, slip back in, slip out. That's a little bit of a sign there, too, that they're not smooth. You don't have smooth processes in place.
Well, and continuing to have leaders like Secretary Panetta who are emphasizing this as a priority issue, you know, not in place of their key functions at, you know, HHS or DOD or whatever, but in along with that leadership at the top really plays a huge role in whether they stay focused and don't slip out.
That's essential. That's essential, as well as continued emphasis from OMB and Treasury.
Yep. Mr. Secretary?
The only thing I'd add would be that, to reiterate what Danny said, is that whether it's the financial report or any other kind of operation or accounting process, you can't jump into it once a year and expect to deal with the issue appropriately. It's got to be an ongoing process, and many of the things that we're working on is to not have the period that we have to issue the financial report to address the imbalances, but throughout the year work with the agencies and OMB and GAO to know what the causes of those are and fix them. So ultimately, when we get to the end of the year, we should be at some point pushing a button and the report is generated and the reconciliations are there.
Great. Thank you. One other quick question. I am going to turn to the ranking member. DOD, obviously a huge part of ever getting to a clean audit. You know, the Secretary has been great in setting the priority there and getting the 2014 with the statements. Do we think that's realistic? In other words, you know, because I think just a few months back we had, I think the CFO at Air Force saying they were going to have trouble meeting the 2017 deadline, and now we're talking about part of that being 2014. Your estimate of whether we can meet that goal, which we need to, and obviously Congress has said we will in law, but we've said some other things in law about financial management that we're not yet achieved. So any idea?
I think this time we have more interim measures to be able to determine whether we're going to make 2017 or not. If you recall in the past, DOD always had an out year estimate of when they were going to make it, but there weren't interim milestones to be able to tell. That's why the Secretary Panetta's decision on 2014 is so important. Mm-hmm. If they can't make 2014 and get audits on the Statement of Budgetary Resources, it's going to be really, really difficult to make the 2017 goal. And so I think over the next couple of years, particularly, you know, I applaud the Marines because they've gone out front, as they usually do, and are trying to get their Statement of Budgetary Resources audited. They're trying for the third time this year. I think every year they're learning more, and hopefully the other services will benefit from their experience. So these interim milestones, Mr. Chairman, I think will give us a better, more realistic assessment than trying to speculate at this time about 2017.
Great.
I absolutely agree. I've talked many times about what I thought was a critical missing piece to the Defense Department's efforts, and it's what I call a moment of truth. For the finance shop, they have many moments of truth at the Defense Department more broadly, but for the finance shop, the rest of government looks at November 15th each year as the day in which they have to hand in their final papers and get graded. And in many, many agencies, that is embedded into performance appraisals, and it's embedded into the manner in which the effectiveness of the CFO and their entire operation is working. But the Defense Department, you know, they've had a disclaimer for so long, they don't have that healthy stress that exists. Mm-hmm. But by Secretary Panetta putting a line in the sand and saying, we will be auditable on the Statement of Budgetary Resources by this date, I know for a fact that internally inside the Defense Department, this is making waves, and people are recognizing that there's a line in the sand, and for agencies like Air Force and others, they're moving in new directions to try to make sure they meet that commitment. And it's a smart line in the sand that he's drawn, because the Statement of Budgetary Resources is so central, the budget execution, whether program managers and field commanders throughout the Defense Department can know what cash they have on hand, what their obligation rate is, what their expenditure rate to meet emerging commitments. That's the bread and butter of what they do. And you can convince people that if you can't pass this test, then it is impacting your mission. Now you're in a place where you'll get more accountability, and I think it's a good place to be.
Great. Ranking Member, Mr. Towns.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I am pleased to see that the rates of improper payments have decreased, as we discussed in our hearing on this matter several weeks ago. Today, however, I want to focus on the President's goals to recapture at least $2 billion in improper overpayments by the end of the fiscal year 2012. So I guess let me ask you, Mr. Werfel, your testimony indicates that Federal agencies are on track to meet or exceed the President's goal in 2012. My question is simply this. If we proceed with 10 new payment recovery audit programs, as been proposed by my legislation and Senator Carper's legislation, would you expect to see a significant impact to the recovery of improper payment funds?
I would. I think that the challenge that we are having right now is making the transition from recovery audits in a contractor vendor payment setting to recovery audits in a grantee making environment. So let me explain that. The recovery audits first launched as a legal requirement in 2002, and it focused on vendor payments. And so we have this, we built up this capacity to send in these specialized auditors and scrub both the agency's books and the contractor receiving the funds books and find errors, keep a portion of what they find, the incentive structure is there, and the process is working very effectively. That was expanded to Medicare, and it was a seamless transition because the Medicare processors operate very much like contractors. There's an expectation that the way they keep their books would be audited and auditable, and the types of transactions between the agency and the Medicare contractors looked and felt a lot like Federal contract payments. So there's familiarity. Where we have been challenged is in expanding that to grants. So we have not yet figured out exactly how to maximize the impact of sending recovery auditors down to states, local governments, universities. It's a much different proposition. There's a lot of different cultural issues. You know, when Federal employees knock on the door of the state government office and say, we're here to audit, show us your paperwork, it's very different than showing up at a Medicare claims processor. And that's something we need to work on. I'll finish by saying that in Medicaid, the Affordable Care Act specifically expanded and the expectation to do recovery auditing in Medicaid, which operates, as you know, like a grant program. And HHS, with this pressure of this healthy pressure of needing to be successful in the Affordable Care Act, has gotten out in front and done a lot of work and issued the regulations and done a lot of outreach to get that Medicaid program started. It started in January of this year. I'm very hopeful that with that program, if it can get off the ground and get off the ground well, that a lot of lessons will be learned that we can carry over to other state and grant programs. And so to go back to your answer, absolutely, Congressman Towns, we will increase, we'll go way above $2 billion if we can expand beyond contracts to grants effectively. We just haven't yet figured out the exact critical path, but Medicaid is going to be a critical moment in time for us.
Right. Thank you very much. Is there anything that we should do on this side to sort of help you implement it?
I think the important point is to keep us accountable. You know, make sure that that we're reporting to you consistently on the different challenges we're seeing in the grants realm, the state and local government realm, so that there's an openness and a dialogue around how to fix this. It may be at some point in time there's a future hearing where this is your first panel and your second panel are state controllers or state finance directors who and you're asking them, help us figure out how to make a recovery audit program work at the state level. This is something that I think is going to require that type of collaboration to make it work.
Right. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
We're going to need to run for votes. I do have some others, and I think it's only going to be about 15, 20 minutes, probably no more than 20 minutes, and I should be able to be back. So I apologize in holding you. Was hoping to get through more. But as a follow-up to your answer, I appreciate the suggestion. I think it's a great one as far as when we're looking at Medicaid and these grant programs to get that insight from the states and how they can better partner with us, something I think we'll look at doing about Auditor General in Pennsylvania or the equivalent position in New York, and to see how we can, because you're right that if we're going to be successful in improper payments in a lot of these areas, especially Medicaid being from a dollar level one of the biggest, we're going to have a better relationship, because it's ultimately at the state level where those dollars are really being spent and need to be tracked. So we're going to stay in recess for approximately 15 to 20 minutes and then continue. Thank you. Hearing will come to order. Offer Mr. Towns his apologies. He's having to run to Energy and Commerce now, so he won't be able to join us. But I do appreciate your patience, and while I catch my breath, having run over and then back to the floor to try to expedite the hearing here. I want to pick up, we were talking about DOD and certainly one of the big challenges. And General Dodaro, in your testimony, you talk about the importance of implementing the enterprise resource planning systems and the number of challenges. And in 2010, when you talked about 6 of the 9 of the critical ERPs had experienced delays, and one of the things that caught my attention was 2 to 12 years of delay that you reference, and that you have made recommendations to DOD to try to improve their implementation of these plans, as well as to deal with the cost of them. And you reference in your testimony cost increases totaling almost $7 billion. Can you expand on what you think the challenge DOD is facing here, and especially if we're talking about 2014 for the that first statement being auditable, 2017 to be able to have the whole department audited, when we see 2 to 12 year delays with implementing ERPs, that's not real encouraging.
You know, basically. The problems that DOD are having here, and I would be happy to submit our detailed reports for the record that where we have outlined all the recommendations, aren't dissimilar from what we see in other IT investment issues across government in terms of making sure you got to have the requirements there, you know, properly outlined, the fact that they have to make sure that they stabilize the systems going forward. I mean, it's proven to be a difficult issue across government in terms of managing these IT investments. And DOD business systems modernization more broadly is on our high-risk list.
Right.
I mean, this is not just isolated in the financial management area, but it's a broader issue. We've recommended that DOD have better enterprise architectures to manage their systems. And right now they have, you know, over 7,000 different systems, 2,000 investments and new ones. I mean, it's a massive activity, and to have an enterprise architecture to guide it. A lot of the information they're going to need eventually comes not just from the financial management community, but from logistics and other procurement and other parts of DOD. So there's two really sets of issues here. One is to have a good architecture where all these systems can be integrated properly, because that's one of the big problems now. And then secondly is to manage the systems using a disciplined process that's put in place. And many of our recommendations go to instituting good practices.
Is it one of the challenges of, as we go, since we're talking multiple years of implementation to then have access to that good information from, you know, when there's a change of administration, does that have an impact of why we see delays estimating 2 to 12 years? Is that a factor, or is it more just that they're not putting in place that architecture to follow along and implement?
It's more than the lack of disciplined systems than it is change in administration.
Yeah.
Although, you know, we've recommended in the past that you need to have a chief management officer,
right,
at the Department of Defense. And right now the deputy secretary is double-hatted, but
yeah,
there's a CMO structure in place in the services and a deputy CMO that reports to the deputy secretary. And so we're watching that very carefully to make sure, and I hope that makes a difference in instituting more disciplined management practices in place. A big challenge DOD is going to have, even if they have the good systems, is getting the right data entry to have reliable data in there. I mean, part of the issue is that you know, they're being able to document a lot of their transactions. I mean, not being able to document some of their transactions was one of the main reasons they couldn't get an opinion on the Marine Corps statement of budgetary resources. So a lot of this is really, I think, you know, better perfecting and having discipline in their record keeping and their systems and the development, which hasn't been a priority in the past.
We're going to be doing a hearing in a couple of weeks with Army related to personnel and accounting.
That you will see that issue vividly
in
that hearing.
And that kind of leads to the broader issue, and you referenced it, John Rodero, and maybe if any of the three of you want to comment, that a number that jumps out is that in the past fiscal year we spent almost $80 billion on IT systems, yet we are still having the difficulty of how those systems are being implemented and then generating useful information. Is there, in the big picture, not just DOD, but any of the departments or agencies, any one issue that as a committee we should be conscious of that IT implementation, expenditure and actual how the money is used, that is most problematic, that we are spending tens of billions and not maybe getting the return on that investment that we hope to?
Yeah. I'd say there's two things the committee could focus on. One is the implementation of this IT dashboard that's been put in place. You know, we've made recommendations. That dashboard is helping because it better tracks the performance of the systems enhancements on cost, schedule, and whether or not they're really going to achieve the results that they're intended to achieve. So there's much more transparency now than there ever has been. We've made further recommendations to make sure that information is most current as possible. But that gives the Congress and the public a window into the performance of these new systems investments. So, and we can work with you to provide you with our recommendations on that area. Secondly, I was here 2 days ago talking about duplication, overlap, and fragmentation of the federal government, and I pointed out at DOD and the Energy Department that we identified 37 different investments totaling over $1 billion that were potentially duplicative. So if you're spreading, you know, your talent out, you know, across more systems than you really have to, and you're not concentrating on managing the performance of a fewer number of systems properly, you're going to have even bigger problems. So the potential having processes in place, investment management processes, to look at the portfolio of programs and make sure that you don't have duplicative investments. And many of these occur in administrative systems, whether they're personnel management systems. We also talked about the Office of Personnel Management and others. Agencies are developing individual case management systems for background investigations on their own, rather than using one common system against government. And I was pleased that OMB accepted our recommendation to work with OPM and to try to streamline that across process. So I think there's plenty of fruitful opportunities for the committee to pursue in this area.
Yeah, I because of being in another market, wasn't able to be at the hearing on Tuesday. But I think, and DOD is a perfect example, that the 7,000 systems that, you know, there's overlap, duplication in those that could have been much better managed, and because it wasn't, now to try to get control or bring it under control is going to be very challenging. So, Mr. Werfel.
Yeah, I'd like to add a few thoughts if I could. First of all, I appreciate Mr. Dodaro mentioning the IT dashboard. Obviously, transparency is the staple of any effective government reform effort, and bringing to light you know, credible and reliable information about the status of projects helps drive accountability. I agree with Mr. Dodaro about the emphasis on duplication and overlap. The one area that I would suggest the committee look into is an area where we've been extremely focused from the start of this administration, and that's on the overall size and scope of our IT projects. Our basic assessment is that we have not historically as a government done a good job in right-sizing the business requirements for these systems. We take on a lot of nice-to-haves in terms of what our systems need to do, and we've bought into, I think, unfortunately, a notion that we can, you know, move to these large single-instance systems that can solve multiple problems simultaneously in a seamless way. And on paper, it looks good, But when you get down to the practicality of whether our government organizations have the capacity to manage the change involved, which is a lot of business process change, it's a lot of data cleanup, it's cultural changes and training, all things that need to happen. But if you take on too big of a project, we tend to never get across the finish line in the way we envision. Yeah. So our emphasis has been on downsizing and downscoping our IT projects across the board into more bite-sized chunks. And here's what that does. It does a couple of key things. By doing that, you get to meaningful points of functionality quicker. So if you've got this large project, and even the best project management team in the world is going to take 5 years to deploy, a lot of the key senior officials involved won't be there 5 years from now. And the taxpayer is not getting the benefit of an active system for another 5 years. If you say, okay, our first landing point will be 18 months from now, and it won't do everything that that the full vision does, but it will give us meaningful return on investment functionality within 18 months, well, first of all, the senior leaders will be there, and on that go-live date there will be a sense of accountability, and it creates a change management environment that's more manageable. Mm-hmm. So we've engaged in financial systems over the summer of 2010. We looked at every financial system project with this thought in mind, and we shrunk the budgets of our financial systems by $1.6 billion just on the notion of you've asked for too much. You've asked for too many nice-to-haves. We're doing that in a lot of other areas. So I think as a government we need to be on a better diet in terms of what business requirements we're asking our systems to do, and look for these shorter bursts of functionality. The challenge we have with agencies like DOD are that they have already, when this administration came on board with this guiding principle of smaller, more targeted, higher priority business needs for our systems, the Defense Department had already launched into these broad ERPs, and it's hard to walk back from the big systems once you're halfway down the football field. I think they are looking very closely at areas where they can, as they're implementing forward, shrink the size of the problem, shrink the footprint of business requirements, make some important adjustments so that they can get to meaningful deployment sooner.
Yeah, I know we saw, and I'm drawing a blank on the name of the program at DOD, where they had spent $100 million over, I think, 7 years, and Dimer, but with no, as you said, result, because of it was just by the time they got far along, it was realized that it couldn't actually do what it needed to do, and taxpayers were out the money without a benefit. So,
yeah, a couple other points I'd suggest along these lines. One is, we pointed out in our report that was released Tuesday, not only duplication systems, but for cost savings opportunities. And one in defense was this next generation email system for the Navy, where they looked at different alternatives, and then they actually selected an approach that wasn't one of the alternatives that they had identified, and it was much more costly and involved many more contractors than any of the alternative approaches. So we recommended reassessing that. What we've been trying to do at GAO is get in earlier in these decisions along the lines that Mr. Werfel mentioned early on. You know, one of the major pieces of legislation that this committee sponsored many years ago is the Clinger-Cohen Act to actually put chief information officers in place across government. And the idea there was to have a disciplined investment management process, to do more modular approaches and not the big systems approach. So I think, this committee has opportunity to look at how well that's working, and we could provide a lot of assistance in that area.
And that might be using a specific example of the Navy system, where we can maybe partner with you to do some productive oversight and help to see if they'll reevaluate, I think, as you said, what their decision was. So, great.
Secretary Gregg, I might add that it actually you can do these things successfully. Just to give another point, one of the Bureau of Public Debt, who is part of the Fiscal Service, is they provide services to other government agencies, accounting services through a franchise activity, and they are well along to implementing an upgraded ERP. They are on time. They are under budget. And they have done that, I don't know, two or three times. And it gets down to identifying exactly what you are going to do and sticking to it and having the management discipline to do that. Minimizing the reliance to the extent you can on outside contractors.
And which, I apologize, I didn't, which agency or office was that?
It's Bureau of Public Debt.
It was
part of the fiscal service. And they provide franchising services to, I don't know, 55 or 60 smaller government agencies in the accounting area. They've done that, and they're on schedule to implement that on.
Maybe we need to loan those, you know, men and women out to DOD on their ERPs.
Well, the one thing that often, I think both Gene and Danny alluded to it, is that these projects tend to grow, and public debt offers a service, and this is what the service is, and it's in one respect maybe somewhat vanilla, but they don't modify it for their customers. This provides basic, good, sound accounting, and they don't deviate from that. If you don't want to come and you know, be their customer, then that's fine. But if you do, here's what you get. And I think that's really paid dividends for them over the years and for their customers in keeping the costs down and the quality high.
Yep. I want to touch on a kind of a different issue, different track. And it relates to one of the audit issues raised by GAO was Medicare cost growth. And Secretary Gregg, in your testimony, you talk about the projected savings because of the Affordable Care Act and what will transpire. And then GAO referenced that as one of the areas of concern. And we probably saw evidence of that just a few weeks back with the payroll tax bill, where, you know, at least for the next 18 months, you know, we're suspending the provider payment reductions, which would have been drastic and ultimately led to less access to care for seniors. I guess, Secretary Gregg, first, if you want to comment, given that that legislation is now passed and is an example of I'll say, the fallacy of the Affordable Care Act on the fiscal impact. There really won't be savings because of that type. I mean, Congress, we're not going to let Medicare provider reimbursements drop 25% or more now, or I would contend ever, because of what it would mean to seniors getting access.
I think two things. One is that the you know, the auditors for the SOCI programs identified, I think, in their view, significant uncertainties about the amount that was identified. Having said that, I think there's still significant savings through the Act.
And yeah, I'm not saying there's not anything in the Act, but you know, if I remember, and this number, my memory is it was maybe 220 or 240 billion over 10 years was specifically related to Medicare provider payment reductions, mm-hmm. and I'm pretty sure it was over 200. I don't remember the exact number. That's a significant, you know, that aspect of the bill.
Yeah, and I think that there was a couple provisions in there where the auditors and NGOs said, well, based on experience, there's some uncertainty whether or not these are going to actually be realized, and I think that was the reason for the disclaimer on the SOCI. But you know, it's on one hand you have a statute that's in place, on the other hand you have past experience that might suggest that additional legislation may come along and modify it.
Yeah, I think it's one of the challenges when we pass the bill, and then as we go forward with audits, whether it was CBO and how they scored the bill, or now how we try to assess its actual impact, is, you know, CBO did what they were required to do, is look at what the bill said and score it based on what it said, even though everyone knew at the time it passed that we would not allow, as we now have not allowed, those payments to drop. Until we get to a more frank or accurate. I'm trying not to use the word honest, meaning I don't think there was any intent of dishonesty, but the reality of the impact was we didn't have an accurate or honest assessment of the impact. We really will struggle with trying to have a true understanding of the fiscal situation or challenges coming, and then how we deal with them. So,
there's really a few things I'd like to comment on this that I think will help shed some light on it. One is, the financial statements were prepared, as you mentioned, in order to assume that the law was enacted.
Right.
But there are uncertainties. Now, a couple of things in that regard. One is the reimbursements to doctors, which you mentioned was deferred, and there's questions about whether that will be continued to be deferred or not in the future. That's one uncertainty. Now, there are provisions in the health care legislation, though, to reduce payments to hospitals that are different, and supposedly the hospitals have agreed to accept those in exchange for greater coverage of individuals under health care. So that should be okay, perhaps, if that arrangement holds over the next decade. Then there is the question of assumed productivity increases in other parts of the health care profession, and that is another degree of uncertainty.
Right.
And so those are the reasons that led us to disclaim to give an opinion on there. And you have a lot of inherent uncertainties in health care field anyway in terms of cost growth, but I just wanted to offer those comments.
Yeah, because we're trying to assess what in reality future Congresses will do, they're always going to have some uncertainty in how we make those projections. And I don't want to dismiss Controller Werfel referenced earlier the Medicaid aspects of the bill of trying to have a proactive approach. Can prevent misuse of funds, is one of those examples of a positive aspect. So while I was opposed to the bill in total, I don't want to dismiss or contend that there aren't aspects of it that I think are wise and good policy going forward. So I want to touch on just a couple of things. And General Dodaro, you talk about in your statement compliance with auditing laws. You referenced earlier the Federal Financial Management Improvement Act and the number of entities still not in compliance and the impact that has. Any of you comment, are we doing a better job? And this has been one of my frustrations, I guess, in whether I was chairman or ranking member here, that we have laws that are not complied with, but there is no consequence for those who fail to comply. Are we doing a better job of sending, and Mr. Werfel, you might have mentioned earlier, like DOD, the fact that the Secretary is saying 2014 we will do this, that there is a better understanding in the Department that there is a hard deadline and there will be consequences. Because unless we have consequences, the deadlines ultimately don't mean anything. Because, I mean, here we have laws that are being ignored and not comply with. Are we doing a better job of sending the message out, whether it is civilian or with DOD, military personnel, that you are given this charge and you will fulfill it, and if not, it will reflect on you from a personal standpoint in your job rating or assessments? Is that culture changing at all?
I think it is. There are examples of statutory requirements where there were no particular sanctions, where the global accountability on it was so high that we were going to make it no matter what. And the example I'm referring to is the Recovery Act.
Mm-hmm.
All the various reporting deadlines within the Recovery Act to get the information out, that we had to stand up a nationwide data system in a matter of months, and it took an enormous amount of combined stakeholder engagement and senior leadership attention to get that all done, all in not just in the name of a statutory deadline, but a broader expectation that Congress, the President, citizen intermediaries like the media, all placed on
so the public, the fact that it was a very transparent public aspect helped to make sure that. Yeah.
And then on the other end of the spectrum, if you have a law that's out there that doesn't have that type of attention, whether inherently within an administration, there's no hearings on it, and the media is not paying attention. You might see situations where statutory deadlines are missed, and there's not a lot of accountability or attention to it. Mm-hmm. I think the place likely to land is somewhere in the middle, where clearly where there are moments in time where a statutory deadline is surrounded by a tremendous amount of attention from this committee, from other committees, from an administration. It feeds off each other. We end up in a situation where these deadlines are consistently met. But you can't prioritize everything,
right.
and you can't expect that in all situations. And for those places where we don't see that, I feel that there can be different things we can do to drive greater accountability, including organically within the government embedding these things in performance appraisals, which is happening more and more thanks to efforts at OPM and others to try to enforce more performance-based work from federal employees, and kind of tying the merit-based promotions and salary increases and things like that. And then there are some creative things that I've seen come out of this committee and on the Senate side and in the area of improper payment, saying if the IG finds you noncompliant, there needs to be a disclosure to the Hill with these kinds of explanations. And there's a transparency element to that, an additional reporting requirement to that can be helpful. So it's finding that right calibration. But yeah, I think there are moments in the federal financial frame where if there's not enough attention to it and not enough teeth in the statute, it's hard to keep everyone in line on every single requirement.
So maybe a good example, and if my good friend Mr. Towns is here, in the coming term, 2013-2014, he would say if he was chairman, and I would say whoever succeeds me as chairman from our side, but that they work with DOD, not wait till 2014, but in early 13, maybe mid-year 13, in getting to that 2014 deadline, that the DOD knows that this committee, whoever is in this chair for the next 2 years leading up to that 2014 deadline, is very public about scrutinizing DOD meeting that deadline.
Yeah, it's like the point Gene was making on the IT dashboard. It's out there. There's a report card for it. It's public.
Yeah.
It reinforces. If there are interim report card moments for the Defense Department that are public, that's going to be a better ingredient for accountability and sustained leadership attention than if we just wait until 2014 and see what happens.
Yeah.
I would offer a couple of observations on this. First, the last update we did at a high-risk list, we took two items off the high-risk list. In both of those cases, over a dozen hearings had been held by Congress since we put the area on the high-risk list to get them off. There is no doubt in my mind that that would not have happened absent congressional oversight and top commitment by the administration. One was the personnel security clearances, where we were way behind in clearing people. And that was a big issue after 9/11. Mm-hmm. And so the deputy for management at OMB and the OPM director led a task force. They focused on it. Congress focused on it. And it got fixed. There were metrics. They moved to a specific period of time. Now, I contrast that to the Anti-Deficiency Act, which has criminal and civil penalties in it. And we know there have been violations, but nobody's ever been prosecuted as a result of those violations. So I think transparency and involvement of top people, where there's a coalescing of administration priority and congressional priority, and things get done. And that is really, I think, the proper vehicle to pursue. You know, I was involved in the original development of the legislation back in 1996 that created the Financial Management Improvement Act. And there was, in draft legislation, there were penalties in there. If you didn't achieve compliance, your budget was reduced by so much. But that created so much problem, and people were afraid, I think rightfully so, of unintended consequences that could occur, that was removed from the final legislation that's in place. But my view is no substitute for congressional and administrative attention.
And that maybe as we look at for the remainder of this year with the number of oversight hearing issues, such as the state cooperation on Medicaid and grant programs, perhaps with Navy and IT and that type of thing, we look at maybe in the fall a one that's DOD specific on where they are, so that kind of set the stage for whoever does succeed me as chair. And as far as getting more attention, I always think about asking the three of you to admit to steroid usage so that we would have more media focus on these important issues. So for a future hearing, we may ask you to start balking up. And I've got, and I appreciate your patience. If I can, maybe two final issues that we talk about, and I always have too many probably for the time frame. But the in the testimony, and I guess it goes to one of the uncertainties and the impact of the economic recovery efforts, and specifically, General Dodaro, you reference the $316 billion in future payments related to Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, and what that ultimate cost is going to be. That number, I've not seen before, and maybe just have missed it, but it's to me was much higher than any estimates I had, which were $150-200 billion. So can you comment on that, is that a pretty, you think, a pretty solid estimate of what that ultimate cost is going to be?
Yeah, so far, and probably the numbers you're referring to that are most often referenced is what's already been paid, which is about $183 billion recently. And we just, this morning in the paper, another disclosure about losses for this last quarter that for one of the GSEs. The 316, there's also a disclosure in there that there may be an additional $60 billion over and above the 316. Now, this changes every year based upon, circumstances and estimates, so we'll have to watch it. But I do think that ultimately this will be one of the greater costs of the financial recovery efforts will be the Freddie Mac and Fannie Mae. And that's setting aside even what the transition issues would be once the Congress settles on what their ultimate disposition should be.
Right.
And so this is something we're watching closely with the estimates. The same way we're watching under the TARP program, we still have to exit from AIG,
right,
General Motors. We've made recommendations to Treasury that they have the expertise to be able to divest there at an appropriate point in time to protect the taxpayers. And so all these investments we're watching very closely going forward.
And obviously that has a huge impact on the bottom line when we talk about future liabilities and our fiscal position.
Oh, definitely, definitely. I mean, Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac are huge entities, and they have a lot of repercussions.
Great. We have been joined by the gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Connolly. Do you have questions?
I do. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you to our panelists, Mr. Dodaro, we heard from just the other day. Mr. Werfel, we've missed you. It was a period of time here in Congress. I thought you had a cot somewhere. But thank you so much for your willingness and patience to share with members of Congress. Mr. Gregg, welcome. Mr. Dodaro, there has been a lot of talk about balancing the budget and ways we can do it. And I want to talk to you a little bit, follow up to the conversation we had at the full committee the other day. But do you remember what the percentage of GDP revenue, federal revenue, represented last time we balanced the budget?
Not offhand.
Would 19.6% roughly sound right to you?
Yes. All right.
And 20.5% the very last year we balanced the budget?
20.
Oh, roughly, give it to them. Roughly, yes. All right.
All right.
And it's somewhere between 14% and 15% today?
Yes.
Yes.
Would it be fair to say that when you look at the fact that we are at 25% spending, which is too high, higher than it was last time we balanced the budget, but revenue is too low relative to that record, that we have to address both sides if we really seriously want to put ourselves on a sustainable path toward balance in the Federal budget?
Yeah, I'm on record as saying we need to address everything, including revenue, entitlements, and other government spending.
Would it be fair to say that it would be a very hard climb to try to balance the budget only on the spending side of the ledger?
Yes.
Thank you. Mr. Gregg, in your testimony, you actually said, you pointed out that the Affordable Care Act reduced Federal outlays and helped reduce deficit spending, if I understood your testimony correctly.
Pardon me?
I said, in your testimony, you talked about how the Affordable Health Care Act actually helped reduce Federal outlays and long term actually will contribute to deficit reduction. Is that your testimony?
And there, Paul, there are some uncertainties on the numbers. The savings are still very significant.
Very significant. Do we have any evidence with respect to, for example, Medicare premiums or Medicare Advantage premiums that maybe the promise of the Affordable Health Care Act is in fact being realized or shows some empirical evidence that it might be? I mean, did Medicare Advantage premiums go up or down the last 2 years?
I'm sorry, Mr. Connolly, I can't answer that, but I can get an answer for you for the record.
Would it surprise you to learn that, as a matter of fact, the answer to that is they went down both years for the first time in the history of the program?
No.
And Medicare premiums this year went down. And in both cases, especially Medicare Advantage, the number of people enrolled, because one of the criticisms of health care reform was it will destroy Medicare Advantage. In both of the subsequent years since passage of the Act, not only did premiums go down, benefits went up with lower cost to the consumer, and the number of people registered actually increased very significantly. Other than that, the predictions of killing Medicare Advantage have been proved correct. We were talking, Mr. Dodaro, the other day about metrics. And one of the things, and I know the Chairman certainly has not only concurred with this concept, but tried to help it along. There are some investments we can make in the Federal Government that actually have huge return on them. And I want to give you the opportunity to revisit the issue of what that ratio was for every dollar we were investing in new resources at GAO. What was the payoff for taxpayers in terms of dollars saved? Just your microphone, Mr. President.
The record at GAO of returning financial benefits for every dollar invested in GAO in the last 4 years was on average $91 to every dollar invested in GAO.
91 to 1?
Yes. Last year was 81 to 1.
And yet what has happened to your budget?
Our budget has been reduced about 8.3% over the last since 2010, and our number of staff by the end of this year will be 11% lower than it was in 2010. That will be the lowest staff level that we've had in GAO since 1935.
You know, I would say to my friend, the Chairman, whose retirement still causes me sorrow, because his voice is going to be very much missed here in the Congress. This subcommittee has done some pioneering work on a bipartisan basis looking at issues like this, improper payments. If we can get our, and Mr. Werfel, you have testified about this, and I hope the Chairman will indulge me just a few more seconds, but we have to get out of this mindless narrative that all spending is the same and all spending is bad. There are such things as strategic investments. $125 billion a year in improper payments, if we could, in theory, bring that to zero times 10, that exceeds the sequestration number we are sweating buckets of blood about around here. If you could have even half that 91 to 1 ratio, let's say in the first year it's that, but you come down a little bit in the next year, it's still a bargain. And instead, we are at the lowest level since 1935, where we're actively disinvesting in opportunities to enhance revenue and to catch waste, fraud, and abuse and mistakes early on and prevent them. That's good for taxpayers. This subcommittee has talked about the need for, and thank God the Congress passed, the Federal Acquisition Institute training bill that I introduced. Mr. Platts was a co-sponsor. It's penny wise and pound foolish not to have highly skilled, highly trained managers of big, large contracts. What could go wrong if you've got somebody who doesn't really know what they're doing?
Lots.
Right. And so we have got to change the narrative around here. And again, I want to thank my friend, the chairman of the subcommittee, who has tried to change the narrative around here about this, because we need to highlight that kind of statistic more. We need to educate our colleagues around here that it ain't all the same and that there are some investments worth making if we share this goal about reducing the deficit and getting our arms around the fiscal situation. Well, what are the tools we need? And all too often we've substituted, you know, ideological rhetoric and political catchphrases that are not a substitute for thoughtful analytical work about what are the analytical tools we need, frankly, to do our job and do it better. So, and Mr. Werfel, I haven't given you an opportunity. If the chairman will indulge one more minute just to allow Mr. Werfel to respond, I thank the chair for his indulgence.
I think you are hitting on a central issue. You know, where are there investments that have a positive return on investment for the taxpayer, in particular in program integrity? Every year the President's budget includes a suite of program integrity proposals that will improve our track record on improper payments in Medicare, and it will improve tax enforcement. The numbers are staggering in terms of the types of savings we can achieve. Over a 1-year window, over a 10-year window, either way, you are looking at very large numbers in the $100 billion range. And often those investments are not enacted through the appropriations process, and it is enormously frustrating that investments that can return dollars and help us in our deficit battle against the deficit are not enacted. So I agree, and I also would emphasize that I think as we move forward as a federal government, the more that we can do to improve the analysis that we have on the return on investment of our dollars, whether it is for GAO or Inspector General shop, a new fraud detection technology that we need to invest in, and we can expose that and make it clear, I think we are better off. And this is an area where this committee can play a critical role in highlighting places in any President's budget, whether it is this one, the next one, or the previous one, where those investments have a positive return to drive down error and improve efficiency. More people need to be singing that song that you are singing and bring attention to it.
Thank the chair for his consideration.
I thank the gentleman for his comments and being right on point. And you know, when you look at the number, the $91 or $83 return for every dollar spent, perhaps the gentleman and I can look as we move into the appropriations process to see if there's a way to, in a bipartisan way, make sure we're making that investment specifically. You know, and being able to make that case of the wisdom of it and the return to the taxpayer. So we're going to conclude and want to thank each of you for your insights that you share with us and given us some more work to do with your knowledge and things that we need to highlight. We will keep the record open, as I said earlier, for 7 days for any additional information you want to provide or members that want to provide a statement for the record. I know I'll have the chance to interact with you some over the next 10 months, but you know, very much appreciate what you do every day and commitment to good fiscal management, which is one of the federal government's most important responsibilities, is how we handle the hard-earned dollars of our fellow citizens. And I know each of you and your staffs are focused very much on that day in and day out, and that's commendable. And when I talk about public service being a calling, what you're doing epitomizes that calling of serving your fellow citizens. So thanks for your testimony and your patience as we had to break for votes. So this hearing stands adjourned.